Place where you can learn, you can discuss, you can get information about stocks in Malaysia, right? It's also a place where you can analyze. It is actually originated from Indonesia, but I think now we are trying to really move the best features of Stockbit from Indonesia to Malaysia. Things such as stock screeners and the ability to open an account or even trade from Stockbit will soon be there. So it's a good place to mingle and get a healthy discussion from Bursa and KLSC actually. How we are different is that we feel like the new millennials, the new generation of traders, they are all in social media. So Stockbit, it caters to the social media technology, right? So you can follow people, you can block people, you can report an abuse, and there is always a profile to have each user. So you know which user you can follow, which user are credible, and a lot of the controls are at the user's hand. Yeah, you can check it out.
Hello, and yes, hello and good evening, everybody. Thank you for joining another live session today with myself and Rondi over here.
Hi, Terence. How are you?
Fine, great, great. How are you, Rondi?
I'm fine, thank you. I was just checking out the TUNEPRO app, actually. It's very user-friendly, I think, you know. I mean, not trying to market it or something. It's just due diligence, right, that we need to do because we have them on today. And I think it's a very simple and nice UI sort of like application. I think everyone who needs some insurance can check it out.
Actually, I also was playing around with the app, right? And I think I really like that you can get a sort of quote of the insurance policies. And of course, you know, insurance policies in the end needs to be customized to your needs, but it's nice to get a ballpark figure of the type of cost you can expect.
Yeah, so I think, you know, before we bring on our guest, right, I find it very interesting, right, Terence, that, you know, a lot of times in Malaysia, especially, we talk about tech sector, right? And in Malaysia, tech sector, we know a lot of the semiconductor players, but they are more like tech manufacturing players, you know, in sort. Not so much on, like, say, a software tech company, right? So, of course, we do have, maybe you can categorize, say, Air Asia, now Capital A, as one of them. Maybe some software companies like the HR company, I forgot the name, Ramsol or something, as another. But I think, you know, what we have here in TUNEPRO, it can be argued that they can actually be labeled as a tech company, right? Or rather, a tech company in the making. So yeah, maybe, you know, for all the hype in Indonesia, how about they are getting all the Bukalapaks and the GoTo? Actually, in Malaysia, there are one or two companies that is coming up to the front, right, for this sort of thing.
Yeah. Definitely, I think TUNEPRO's, you know, it's a software-based app after all. And we talk about, right, tech and the sort of programming and the apps that are very scalable when they are producing their services.
Mm-hmm. Okay, shall we bring our esteemed guest?
Yes. Hello, Rohit.
Hello,
aboard.
Everyone. Hi, Terence.
Good evening. Good evening.
You can call me Rohit, Rondi.
Hello. Yes, hi, Rohit. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Great.
Good. Great. I personally have been following your good self, you know, in your fintech talks and everything. And I'm very interested to know more about your company, actually.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
Maybe just a question first, Terence, if you don't mind, right? And yeah, sure. Before we maybe get into the presentation from Rohit, because you know, like we all know that insurance is a very, very old sort of like industry. It goes back decades, right? Just want to find out more about the industry, right, Rohit? Like, how is it different today than what it was, say, when you started in the industry 10 years ago? And how is it different compared to, say, Warren Buffett era, like 50 years ago? Would you actually also say that, you know, currently this term, which is sort of like being labeled everywhere, insurtech, would you say that insurtech is actually disrupting the industry? Or is it merely just digitalizing, improving the old way of doing things, or it's in between? For instance, what I'm trying to say is maybe insurtech is disrupting just a segment of the insurance industry, say, trying to eradicate the insurance agents and so forth.
Sure. Thanks, Rondi. I think a little bit of an update of how insurance works, right? So insurance obviously started in the 1800s in UK, and it was started on a mutual concept, right? But over a period of time, it evolved. It started covering a lot of different types of policies. In the last 20 to 30 years, it's boomed in Asia and in ASEAN for sure. It's boomed, right? Why has it seen that kind of growth? Because there are more affluent people. There are more mid-net worth people who had more money in their hands. They wanted different avenues to save their money. So naturally, the business lend itself to a certain type of distribution channel. Banks had presence to access to this customer base. Agents had access to their friends, their relatives, etc. And these models, for example, in life insurance was very high margin. So because it was high margin, the new business margins in Asia are the highest in ASEAN, are highest in the world, actually. And for that reason, you could be a feet on street model, which means you actually have people going and meeting people and selling. But and because for the last 20 years, there was double digit growth and it's very profitable, nobody saw a burning platform to disrupt that model. Then came the Zillennials and Millennials, who don't buy insurance the same way that, you know, our parents bought it, right? So the whole buying pattern is fundamentally changing right now. A few years back, everybody wanted the most comprehensive insurance policy. Every time you bought, your question was, does it cover everything? Today, people are saying, I want affordable, I want simple, and I want to choose. So when these three requirements happen, products have to become more bite-sized. It cannot be your comprehensive all covered product, which is very confusing that nobody understands what it's covered. And that's why you need advice. You need someone to take you through it. So now the new insurance is more simpler. You can easily access it. It's more affordable. And then if you want to buy more, you can buy more. So at TuneProtect, our concept has been always that of very similar to an Amazon or an AirAsia. Our concept is, as a consumer, you want to buy a seat when you fly in an airline. Which seat you sit in or what food you eat, you then want to choose. You may decide not to choose a seat. You may decide not to pay for food and just travel. So you want to travel no frill cheap. You may decide that, no, I want to sit in the front. I want to have nasi lemak. I want to do everything. You pay, you do. The same way, if you go on our mobile app and you buy our home easy policy today, our basic product, we have a challenge running that if you find a cheaper product today in the market, we will make good your difference. Okay, that's the challenge. We have a price challenge and say you cannot find something cheaper. But it's the same concept of a no-frill concept. However, if you have more money, if you want to spend more, you want to buy more complex product, you can just click, click, click and buy more features. No problem. It's as simple as that. You can do it on our website. You can do it on a mobile app. So the whole concept is about listening to the customer. And this is a Lazada Shopee generation. If you sell the same way that you sold 20 years back to them, you won't win these customers. Having said that, there is a market for agents. There is a market for banks. There is a market for brokers. So there are two different markets that exist. But you cannot ask a millennial or zillennial to buy insurance the same way they bought it earlier. A last example on this one. Today, you can buy a health insurance product from TuneProtect at an average premium of 600 ringgit. For someone who earns, say, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 ringgit, 50 ringgit a month is very affordable. But the average health insurance otherwise is between 2,000 to 3,000 ringgit. For that same person to pay 200 ringgit a month or 300 ringgit a month is a lot. So what we are saying is you can start at the affordable level, and as your wealth creation happens, as you earn more, you can always dial up your sum insured. So that is kind of what we are trying to create. And your question on InsurTech. InsurTech has two angles to it. One is InsurTechs who are simplifying insurance. What does that mean? They help traditional insurers to simplify claims, traditional insurers to simplify operational processes. Then there are InsurTechs like us who are disrupting the front itself. We are saying today, you can buy online from me, you can claim online from me, you can service online from me, you can do all of that online for me. And I provide a tech. So many times people, as you rightly said, today I wrote something up on my LinkedIn. I said, just to let you know, 2 years from now, 20% of my employees are going to be technology. Yeah. Okay, 20% of my employees are going to be technology. What does it tell you? My outlook of insurance has always been that insurance in the past was an insurance business which used technology. My view of the future is we'll all be technology companies who specialize in insurance. Because at the end of it, I can automate underwriting. What is underwriting? It's rules. What is underwriting for the layman? Underwriting is the process of me when Rondi gives me a policy request for me to understand what his risk is. Or same with Terence, what is the risk, right? We can automate it. Earlier, we had people looking at it. Today, we can automate it because we need to put the rules. And there can be someone who's looking at the rules regularly, analyzing it. Claims, again, it's rules. It can be automated. You can use AI, you can use technology, you can use RPA. So a lot of processes will get automated and people will be used for what they should be used for, which is just having the talk that we are having today, building relationships, customer service, analysis, etc. And not necessarily for data entry and, you know, basic mundane work. So that's my outlook. I think InsurTech is also evolving. There was a phase, if you ask me, 5, 6, 7 years back, when big insurers said InsurTechs are a threat, and InsurTechs thought, here I am, I'm going to disrupt all the insurers. A few years later, both did not happen. The big guys realized they are too big and too slow, and they need InsurTechs. The InsurTechs realized they are too small, too nimble, they need the big people. And now you can see a lot more working together. So that's why, for example, even we have non-TuneProtect customers today. We actually provide tech to non-TuneProtect companies. And I can talk about that later. And that's an example where much bigger companies are saying, wow, you're cool. Your tech is cool. Let me use it. But the only thing is I won't use it in Malaysia and Thailand because then I lose my competitive advantage.
Mm. Okay. Thank you, Rohit, for the answer.
Yeah.
Some industry insight.
Yeah.
Shall we bring on your slides on, Terence?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, Rohit. Sorry, go ahead. Maybe the floor is yours again.
The floor is yours again.
So, I try to keep it simple. If I'm getting, you know, complex, you know, feel free to just message me and let me know and I can simplify it. Because at the end of the day, I'm an insurance professional, so I might tend to become technical. So,
understand.
For those of you on this meeting, I want to introduce TuneProtect again to all of you, right? It's very important for you to understand who TuneProtect is. TuneProtect is a listed insurer in Malaysia. We today have businesses in Malaysia and Thailand. We have insurance businesses in Malaysia and Thailand. We are leaders in travel insurance in these markets. Very good presence in personal accident and other lines of business, which I'll talk about. We have a digital facilitator business in Middle East, which is growing 6 times in the last 2 years. We have an insurtech business in Malaysia, which not only provides insurtech for our companies, but starting to work with other companies. And Prashanta, who's our CTO, will be talking later. And we have a reinsurance business, which it today operates in more than 30 countries. It can activate multiple opportunities in one go. It's many times not understood because we are compared with traditional insurers, and we aren't traditional insurers. Now, what has happened to TunePro? We got listed in early 2013-14. The first 3-4 years of the company between 2010 to 2016 was 2011 to 2016 was very good. You know, travel insurance was growing. You all know Tune Protect was sold with the AirAsia ticket and everybody bought it, etc. Then there was an FSA rule that came where you can't compulsorily sell travel insurance, and the business dropped. And the business obviously went through its own set of challenges of how to come through this phase. Since 2020, we have pivoted the business to not only focus on travel insurance, to not only focus on one line of business, but to expand our business. And that's why we came up with a few commitments. And I'm a firm believer in long term. I don't believe in managing quarterly results, because as Jeff Bezos said, anyway, the next quarter's results, the decisions were taken long time back. And to show you as shareholders, as potential investors, the confidence, we have a 2023 strategy, which we launched in 2021, which was last year. And every quarter, we have been showing how we are performing against it. So I'm going to talk about that briefly. We said that, so a few things. There are two fundamental issues for TunePro. One was TunePro was not growing. The second was TunePro was not retaining enough business. What does retaining enough mean? Is many times we were reinsuring the business out. So for insurers, there's something called reinsurers. There's somebody else who can insure a reinsurer. So we were reinsuring too much, which essentially meant we were just fronting a business. So that did not make economic sense. So we announced to the market that we want to have a high growth. Our internal targets, we want to grow between 25 to 33%. And I can tell you last year we grew at 19.5%. And we are very much confident that we will work.
Hello, guys. I'm not sure what happened. Please give us a minute while we fix this technical issue. Yeah, just a moment, yeah, guys. Bear with us for a bit.
Sorry, I cut off the
line. Yeah, sorry about the technical problem. I believe you need to re-upload your slides.
Yeah, I'm just going to do that.
Just give us a minute, yeah.
Sorry about that. I was suddenly talking to myself. Okay.
Okay. Here we are.
Okay, good.
All right.
Thank you. Yeah. So moving on. So what we want to do is we want to grow between 25 to 33%, and we are very confident we will grow. The second one is we want to retain more business. Today, we retain around 35% of our business in Malaysia and 25% in Thailand. You will notice it improved, and then it improved further. And I'll talk about that later. So there were 8 commitments we gave, and I'm going to talk about those 8 commitments so you can see how we are evolving as a company. And every quarter you will hear me talk about the same thing. So the first one, we want to have greater retention, and we chose 3 lines of business. Why did we choose 3 lines of business? Why did we choose health insurance, lifestyle, and SME? And what's lifestyle for the common person? Lifestyle insurance is travel, lifestyle insurance is pet, lifestyle insurance is home insurance. So basically around your lifestyle. What research proves is, as I mentioned in the beginning, our focus is millennials and zillennials. When you walk on the road and speak to a 50-year-old in Malaysia, they're not going to say Tune Protect is the first name that comes to their mind. They're going to have the top three, top four names, which you've all heard of. And for that reason, we need to have a differential positioning, right? It's like when you buy a dumbbell from Lazada, you probably don't know what brand you're buying it from, right? So it's the same way, we have to reposition to a different generation. So for that reason, we understood what matters to a millennial or zillennial. There are three things that matter to a millennial or zillennial. The first thing is travel. They really want to travel. Wait for COVID to open and they're ready to travel, right? The second one is their lives depend around the mobile phone, right? They're very, very keen on different things around their mobile phone. The third one is they're very health conscious, because 48% of Malaysia, as you know, is overweight. And the younger generation is a lot more health conscious because of what I call the Instagram generation. So that's why we have focused on three lines of business. And you will notice all these three lines of business has high retention ratio. As you can see, in the case of health, it's 98%. In the case of lifestyle, it's 80%. In the case of SME, it's 71%. And what's important is all these three lines of business are also profitable. And what we also noticed in a very difficult year last year, you all know it was COVID. Despite COVID, we grew 19.5%. So it should tell you that we were able to grow in a very difficult year. And we noticed in Q4, our Malaysian business grew 35%, excluding reinsurance. So you can see the growth is coming back, and I'm very confident that growth will sustain, if not higher. Moving on, we are noticing a strong growth in travel. Many times I hear this comment that, you know, we are dependent on AirAsia. First of all, for us, we are proud to be associated with AirAsia, right? Because 75 million customer, there's a certain achievement they have, a certain brand, etc. Now, beyond that, however, we have also shown the market that last year, less than 7% of our business came from AirAsia, and we were only 6% below pre-COVID levels on our full year sales. So just let that settle in for a minute. Yeah, what I'm saying is, our travel insurance business last year was already, without AirAsia flying, as you know, most of Malaysia, Thailand, etc., was locked down, was already only 6% lower than 2019 when the world was open and AirAsia was flying. So you can imagine this year what's going to happen once the borders open and AirAsia flies again. Pre-COVID, AirAsia was 80%, 90% of our total sales, which was roughly about 20% of our total business. And today, AirAsia is less than 10%, but we are still maintaining pre-COVID levels, only 6% lower. And that should tell you the opportunity that's ahead of us. How did that happen? It happened because of four reasons. First thing is we have AirAsia, which is our main engine for travel insurance. The second thing is we have a growing business in Middle East. We have two airlines there, Air Arabia, Salam Air. And we also have 2,500 travel agents using our InsurTech platform to sell insurance. The third thing is in Vietnam, we have Bamboo Airways. We've also signed up another airway, which we'll be announcing. We've already indicated to the market it's coming. And we have many other platforms we are working there. And the fourth one is we've started working with other travel platforms. We just went live with Agoda in Indonesia, and we are constantly going live with different players. So you can see how we are very, very diverse as a business group. Today, AirAsia contributes less than 5% of my total sales. So you can imagine, this is not travel, I'm saying total sales. So you can imagine the positive impact that will have when AirAsia starts flying again. We are seeing a strong pickup again in our Malaysian business. As I mentioned, in Q4, we are growing at 38%. So it's clearly a strong growth. We have been very innovative. Our Thailand business launched a very unique critical illness product. What normally happens with critical illness is when you buy a critical illness product, you are sold a 38-64 critical illness product. And what happens with 38 and 64 critical illness is it's too complex. Sometimes even 100, I've heard. It's too complex. It's too costly. We are creating a make your own critical illness product where as a customer, you can choose one critical illness, two critical illness, three critical illness. You can choose in Thailand and you can make your own critical illness. You know why? It's cheaper. And 90% of critical illness, more or less 90%, comes only from cancer, heart attack and stroke. So for people, for the millennial and zillennial, they can buy a simpler critical illness. As they get wealthier, they can buy more. We were the first ones to launch COVID travel in Thailand, in the Middle East. In Malaysia, you know, our inbound COVID travel pass is doing very well. We launched Tenang PA Care in 2022 in February. It's seen some good results. So we're constantly innovating. We have second medical opinion on our health insurance products. We have teleconsulting on our health product. So we are constantly launching new products. We have pet travel in Middle East. And I think I briefly spoke about the home insurance product earlier. So we are different from a traditional insurer in the sense that we really look at millennials and zillennials and create simple products digitally you can purchase or through an advisor or through a partner. But the idea is the customer group we want to focus on. This is our biggest win, and you will see those numbers coming through. I always say, if you find any insurer, and this is absolute confidence I'm telling this, if you find an insurer who can work faster than me, let me know. It's my new challenge. Nobody in Malaysia or Thailand today can work faster than me. And that's my biggest achievement. Because I have APIs, which means I can connect to partners seamlessly. My products are simple. I have a digital culture and I am always disruptive. The speed at which we can do things, nobody can do. I'll give you one example. When the Langkawi travel box was open or the sandbox was open, we got a call on a Friday evening saying we are one of the three chosen insurers. On a Saturday morning, we had a briefing session. And they said that Wednesday, it's the sandbox is opening and they will do it manually. We said, no, we'll do it digitally. And we were the only insurer to go live on Wednesday at 2 a.m. in the morning. The other two insurers, 4 months later, has still not gone live or did not go live. So that tells you we did it in 3 days. The latest Super Plus, which AirAsia is selling, we have COVID cover in that, cancellation cover. We went live in 20 days. So for insurers, that's pretty unheard of. For example, in Thailand, we have 630,000 Shopee merchant consignment insurance transactions that we have done. What does this mean? If you buy a product on Shopee in Thailand, if the product doesn't reach the buyer or if the product is damaged, we will get it. We will take care of it. So it's really simple insurance that you just tick and you add. So for us, we just went live today with Eco World. You can see that. We went live with Insta Home 2 days back. So we are constantly going live with new companies, new partners with extremely unique offers. You go online, you check us on Koala, you'll find us. You go to Bijak, you'll find us. You go to Policy Street, you'll find us. You go to Ringgit Plus, you'll find us. Food Panda today, their PA, their drivers use our PA, which of course Policy Street distributes. Shape with Shopee Food, AirAsia of course uses us. So that's how we have really grown in the market. So it's really digital partnership, digital distribution. And as this happens, naturally, our expense ratio will improve because as the top line improves, our expense ratio will improve. When that happens, the bottom line will improve, which is good for all of us. So our focus is to grow the business. I'm going to invite Prashanta, who's our Chief Technology Officer. I'm very proud to have him associated with us. He's worked in almost every country one can think of. He's very innovative, very disruptive. And today, technology is a key differentiator for us as an organization. And Prashanta, over to you.
Thanks, Rohit. I mean, Rohit, you have already mentioned that we are here to leverage our tech to increase the business, right? I mean, and but we won't be doing it in Malaysia and Thailand to lose out on the competitive edge. Now, what does it mean? So it means we can go to other markets like we are doing currently in Middle East, where we are working with the local underwriters, where we give the APIs, we give the tech platform, and we give the product. So far, we have been doing that. Now, as a step forward, what we are doing further, we are taking out not only the product, but we say that, okay, we have a platform, even if we don't distribute our product, you can use for anything to build on that. Now, what does it mean? Can we move to the next slide? Next one, please. Thanks. So what we are saying, we are doing a white label offering of InsurTech as a service, where we have APIs, we have product configurator, we have intermediary microsites. So what does it mean? So if you have agents and you the agents want to sell the products digitally, we can create and build very quickly agency microsite. And we can have the logo of the agents, whatever they want to put it up. It is built on a low code. We have a mobile app, and which can be white labeled and given to others. We have claims. We have parametric and UBI. What does it mean? Which means what we have done with parametric. I give an example. So in Vietnam with our partner, what we have enabled that you buy a insurance, travel insurance, and the flight is delayed, you get paid immediately to your digital wallet. If you have bought it using credit card or some other method, we send you an SMS where you click the URL and you just claim it. But if it is digitally and we know the digital wallet, we just credit you out there. Our product platform do support embedded insurance, so which means today what you see in Grab and all, the tech is ready in that way. So from point A to point B, you go as an add-on. If you want to buy insurance, we can do that. We can give it to anyone. So I visited Middle East, and I just came back last week. So we did spend some time with the partners out there, and there are some potential leads around that. And there are multiple platforms out there. So we call it, one of the key one is the pricing and the product configurator. We call it a digital accelerator, which means all the insurers have more or less have very old platform. They cannot digitally distribute the product. Now, with this platform, what we call as a digital accelerator, it will have those APIs connect to your legacy core system, and you can build any product. It could be bite size, it could be micro insurance, I mean, whatever you call it, we can. So with one of the insurers, I'm proud to say we are working on pet insurance, eyewear insurance in Middle East, and that will be done through this tech. So that insurer will use our tech to distribute those product and create those product, right? Now you might have seen here two stars, which is live chat and CRM. These are the two things which we have partnered with other players because these are not key to our business, but as an offering, we put it in the ecosystem. So if someone says, oh, we need a CRM also, we partner with that company and we give it up because this is readily available. But more important is the digital accelerator platform. Along with that, how we do in B2B, we do have 2,500 partners in Middle East, and then people who are keen to have that distribution platform. I can't give out the names right now because we are in the form of signing NDA. One of the countries, one of the leading insurers have asked us, can we get that platform white label? They want to distribute product. and they want to distribute not travel product but other products for their agents. I said, yes, why not? So this is how we are going to monetize our insurtech. So we will give it as a license. It is a low key entry, which means we have taken a conscious decision that we won't go and fight for RFPs or tenders, because that's a waste of effort. And there are bigger players will go and fight. We say that we will put a digital accelerator on top of your legacy core, and you can distribute product through any channels and any platform. Rohit, can you go back to the previous one, please? Yeah, we have built the entire product as a cloud native, so which means we can deploy it on any cloud. Now, in Middle East, the B2B platform is running on AWS. So what does it mean? It means we are cloud agnostic. We are the first insurer in Malaysia who has got an approval to put a core system on a public cloud. Now, what does it mean? It does mean cost savings. It does mean green IT. We talk about elasticity and scale. But more importantly, what it means that the team can focus on other core areas. So today, when you are racking and stacking in your data center, you have to put people to do a lifecycle management, patching, and all those. Now, team will be freed from that. So the cloud provider will handle all those, so the team can focus on the core areas. It does mean innovation. So what does it mean? Now, tomorrow, we go to a health tech or some other areas. So we can do a quick innovation where we connect to those platform and offer services back to our customers out here. It does mean green IT, so you spend low emission and all on our data center. And we have started with the core system, but we are going to take all our critical systems to cloud one by one. So our principle has always been modular. It has been so the latest technology is on open source, so the total cost of ownership comes down, and more importantly, very nimble footed, so that we can deliver those things much quicker. Rohit, back to you.
Thank you, Prashanta. Okay, moving on. So we do want to expand our business. Because why do we want to expand our business? Because the beauty of our business is the tech is the same, right? The mobile app you find in Malaysia, which I would urge you to download and try it out. It's something we pride ourselves in. The mobile app you would find in Malaysia will be the same one you will find in Thailand. And for us, as we expand our business, we will become an ASEAN-based insurtech. That's the vision. That's the dream. And our positioning is earlier, right? I'm not naming the three-letter company who's very popular. 100 years back, when they set up an Asia-based insurance franchise, it was for high-value, high-margin agency, right? And you know it's a multiple billion-dollar company today. What we want to do is an ASEAN-based insurtech for millennials and zillennials. So it's a very similar ambition, but a different positioning. For that to happen, obviously, we're going to expand our business. Our preference is to expand to Vietnam and Indonesia, because these markets have always been higher growth multiple, more opportunity, low penetration, a lot of great things happening there. So we are constantly looking for opportunities to expand there. We want to be a mobile-first company. I've talked about this. What does a mobile-first company do? Very simple. We always think about how to simplify a product so the customer can buy in the simplest possible way. And when you think mobile-first, automatically, I can't put a 20-page document on a mobile phone. Automatically, my product has to be very simple. It has to sit in a mobile phone. And our mobile app, you can buy a product, you can claim, you can service, you can renew. And come June, we will also have our health tech proposition up there, which means by the end of the year, we can do hyper-personalization and hyper-customization, which means if you are someone who has a motor car with us, motor car insurance with us, you drive properly, you have pay as you drive, then I have your driving data, I have your health data. I could give you discounts which say, okay, you've driven very well, you've taken care of your health, here's 20% off, right? So that's kind of the strategy we want to get to. And we're seeing very good growth on our mobile app, as you can see with the numbers over there. Okay, moving on. This is something we pride ourselves. Why do I say this? Some studies say that the average insurance NPS, so what is NPS for those who may not be aware of it? It's net promoter score or net customer satisfaction. The net promoter score or customer satisfaction for insurance is generally negative. You'll all remember Lemonade in the US. Lemonade in the US are very clear. Lemonade cannot become number one in a market, right? And that's why market share is sometimes not a good measure, because you might want to be number one only in your preferred markets, not in your overall business. So Lemonade came out and said, we want to be the number one in customer satisfaction, because then there's a difference you will see. And it's very similar for us. We've not copied them, but it's very similar for us. We want to be an NPS leader. And if the market is at negative, and if we can show a strong positive, customers will naturally observe us. A partner net satisfaction is plus 78. A customer net satisfaction is plus 14 now. And it went from minus 16 last year. What this means is customers will buy more from us. Customers will be happy with us. Customers will be ready to work with us. That's the whole idea. And we've come out with a very interesting commitment. And I'm very proud of this commitment. With us, you have a 3-3-3 commitment. 3 minutes to buy. 3 hours, we will respond to you. And in 3 working days, we'll pay your claims for retail claims, not big buildings. Yeah. And of course, cashless in the hospital is excluded. In some countries, we have parametric claim. And I want to talk a little bit about this. Did you know a little bit about TuneProtect? You know, we actually offer parametric claim in Vietnam. What does parametric claim mean? Your flight is delayed. We will pay you your claim. You don't need to worry about telling us, because we get the data and we'll pay you the claim instant. We actually offer travel insurance today through our mobile app for a ride-hailing taxi in Vietnam, where if the taxi is going to the airport, we will pick geotagging. We'll send the customer a reminder saying, did you buy travel insurance? He or she says, yes, can buy travel insurance. You can see how cool the tech is, right? We have more than 2,500 partners using our B2B portal and API services in the Middle East, which obviously says that not only are they just selling, but they are now their tech is linked, not easy to link it out, right? We are actually zero paper in all our in-control processes, and I'll come to that later. During the recent floods, I'm very happy to say that 87% of our flood claim settlement was done within 3 days. And this feedback about us, you can actually see it in many online places. We are constantly being spoken about as quite different. We also want to be an employer of choice among millennials. If you have to service millennials, millennials have to like working for you as well. So we've done a host of things. We are fully agile. You come to my office and you ask me for where is my office. It can be any chair anywhere in the 2 floors of the building. I don't have an office, nor does anybody. We are casual. We can dress casual 5 days a week. We are fully agile, flexi working hours. We have 90% of our team is white belt at least. We have an e-learning platform. And our culture is known as fun and uncomfortable. We want people to have fun, but we want people to be uncomfortable. Okay, moving on. We all know ESG is very, very important. And from an ESG perspective, we've done several things. Last year, we were very proud to say that we are zero paper for all in-control processes. You will not see us using paper for any in-control process unless it's legal, regulatory, etc. And very small, but you know, you can see the impact of that, even from a cost perspective, but also from a efficiency perspective. We use customer satisfaction. We are the only insurer in the FTSE for Good Bursa Malaysia Index, which should make us all very proud of. And you can see our rating has constantly improved. We are in the top 25th percentile. And we actually have done two very interesting things, which, again, are really unique. One, do you know if you buy an online policy from us, except travel and PA, we give 6 ringgit to Yayasan Chowkit's health fund, which helps people who cannot afford healthcare. So when you buy insurance with us, we are also giving back to the society on your behalf at no additional premium. So that is how we are constantly working. And we've also announced a few other things, like we have 10% of our investment now in ESG equity funds. We won't invest in coal, etc. And we have a stated commitment by 2023, 50% of our leadership will be women. And right now, I'm happy to tell you we're at 40%. And it's very positive as a group. Okay. I'm going to invite Hao. Hao Kim Lian. How can I? Can you hear me, Hao?
Hi, Mr. Hao, I think you might need to unmute yourself.
Okay, if Hao is having some challenge, let me play the CFO role for some time. So in terms of our fourth quarter performance, our net written premium grew by 17%. Our year-on-year growth was 19.5%. For those of you who may not understand, what is underwriting profit is the core insurance profit. The core insurance profit, we actually made a profit last year from a loss previous year. So you can see that the core business is improving. We also made a positive margin, which is what is called combined ratio. I'm trying to explain this in simple terms because I was told by the team that there will be a wide mix of people. However, on a profit basis, we made a loss due to two reasons. One, as you know, the bond market, which is 82% of our investment, had its worst year in 25 years. And we also did some equity and, you know, China had a 23-25% drop last year. So our investment losses kicked in. And the second one was our Thai business had a loss due to some past business, which we have cleaned up as well. But I do believe that, you know, the investment situation is a global phenomenon. And obviously, when you're a smaller business, it hit you. But the core business actually made profit and we grew as well. During the flood, many of you asked a question, is flood a big issue? I think we had good reinsurance control. And unfortunately, which is something we need to educate the consumers, not many Malaysians have flood cover. And that's where the exposure was very limited for us and it didn't affect us, as you can see. We did have a challenge on the investment performance due to the rise in global bond yields. We took a very conservative strategy. For the last 7-8 years, it's given us the results. Last year, unfortunately, was a terrible year for the bond market. We have since made two adjustments. The first one is we have actually shortened our bond tenure. Our bond tenure moved from 4+ to 2.8 years. So that's something we have done. The second one, at the beginning of the year, we did invest in equity. We invested up to 10%. It's roughly around 8% now. And that's something we are holding on. And we believe that this will eventually come true because the markets we've invested are definitely good markets. TPT, many of you may ask, oh, Thailand had a loss, but it's a high growth business. They doubled their net written premium last year. They won the best online insurance company in Thailand. We should be proud for a Malaysian brand to get the best online insurance company in Thailand. number one in travel in Thailand. Their business doubled last year. So obviously we had to hire, you know, some really new staff, new skills, invest on technology and so on and so forth. But we remain confident that the business will break even. The business is actually expecting to continue to grow at 40% at least. And the business is expecting to further invest on technology, which we are doing at the group level. What is our 2022 outlook? We believe that things are going to come back. We are cautiously optimistic. Travel is opening up literally as we speak. 2 more days, fingers crossed. More and more countries are opening up. We are slowly start seeing the volumes go up as well. We also believe health insurance awareness will spike because pandemic always drives that. And our strong partnership framework should help us. On the investment side, we expect volatility to continue because of potential interest rate hikes in both USA and Malaysia. However, we have repositioned for a more defensive portfolio and we will continue to monitor the outlook. We are investing on a new core system, which is all mentioned before. We're changing our core. I'm happy to say we are the first insurer in Malaysia to get approval from Bank Negara to put our core system on the cloud. It's a pretty big achievement, as you can see. That also tells you that we are a technology-based insurer. And we expect to see significant improvements driven by that once it goes live at the end of this year, early next year, the core system. And we further expect strong momentum from our digital partnerships that I mentioned about earlier today. That's it from my side. And I wanted to give enough time for Q&A, so I shall stop here. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Rohit, for the very in-depth guiding us through, you know, the business and how all your how you measure yourselves. I think that's a very clear and very good transparency that you have displayed, which is, you know, I've been following TUNEPRO for quite some time, and it's really good to see also that you have taken a lot of effort in the transparency segment, right, to always have these kind of sessions to inform your shareholders about what you're doing. So yeah, thumbs up to that, definitely.
My pleasure.
All right, so now is the Q&A session. For all our viewers, if you have any questions, feel free to leave it in the comment section, yeah, and we will attend to them when on a first come first serve basis maybe. And yeah, so Rondi, let's begin the Q&A.
Okay, maybe I will start lah, Terence. All right. So Rohit, as you know, our Stockbit community is an investment community. So perhaps let's start from there, because from what I hear from you, there are actually several very, very bright spots for TUNEPRO. Because, you know, you mentioned, for instance, number one, the Thailand associate is basically recovering, okay, trying not to be loss making in the future. Number two, of course, we know that your revenue in Air Asia is just going to come back, and then you have a lot of partnerships which should actually helps to give you some more business in terms of your insurance. And just now, as you mentioned, the only thing which, you know, where we are a little bit uncertain is about your investments, right? And of course, people like Ken is asking, you know, how is the investment portfolio doing? Because I think this is something which it's really up to the market, I suppose.
Yeah.
And I think there is someone who asked a very good question. So yeah, maybe I'll just bring this up. So Brian here is asking about the investment portfolio, but perhaps if I may add into his question, basically how much of your investment portfolio is in bonds, equities and money market? I think you have a slide to show that. The capital market volatility is actually causing big swings in your financial performance and also result, you know, which whether you like it or not, the Malaysian retailers, the layman retailers in Bursa, right, and even some fund managers is marking a company off fundamentally, right?
Yeah.
So with someone nowadays, you know, I was just also looking into some of my US dollar bond investments, and all the managers are basically saying that, you know, fixed income is pacing itself for the worst year in decades, right? Things are actually not looking good so far in 2022 in terms of fixed income investments. So I suppose coming back to Brian's question, how is TUNEPRO managing its investment portfolio? Is there actually a committee to decide? Do you guys have like a chief investment officer or a committee? Is there any way or maybe even like accounting tweaks that the company can do to actually minimize this volatility, which actually, again, is due to market factors? And when do you think TUNEPRO's core business can be big enough so that the market volatility will be insignificant to the financials?
Good question. So a few things, right? So first of all, fourth quarter 2021, equity was 8% of our portfolio. Around 82% was bonds, fixed, etc. And then cash and other, you know, fixed deposits, etc. was 8%. So that'll give you a sense of the mix. Of course, we have an investment head. He reports to the CFO. How we have an investment committee at the board level, which is a subcommittee of the board. It reviews it regularly. So definitely. Now, what I think all of us need to recognize is when you're a general insurance company, right, you can't be a cowboy. So by nature, I can't put a lot of money in equity markets. Some companies, I know some listed insurer in Malaysia benefited also from having exposure to a single stock, which was a dividend paying stock, right? I'm sure you all figured it out. I can't have that kind of exposure because I'm a general insurance company. So what we tend to do is obviously we tend to have a more conservative portfolio. And unfortunately, as I mentioned before, last year was the worst bond market performance in 24 years since 1999. So it was really a one-off. So the question is, when the last 7-8 years, we benefited from bond and last year we did not. So is the strategy good or bad, right? So in hindsight, I think most investors will take 7 or 8 good years versus one bad year. Than the volatility you have with higher exposure to equity, high risk investments, etc. So I would say that in terms of how things would be, it's difficult, obviously, with the Russia-Ukraine conflict, oil situation, etc. But what we have done is we've diversified our portfolio. We put it in equity. Unfortunately, as I said, China also tanked last year. So that also impacted us. But do we expect China to come back? I expect it to. I think my team expects it to.
It's been recovering like the past 1 month.
Precisely. So it has been recovering. But of course, with the short lockdown, there may be some short, you know, up and down. But yeah. And towards the end of the year, we actually reduced we made a more defensive portfolio. So our average tenure has reduced from 4.5 to 2.8. So there's less volatility as well. So this
in
is
in terms of your investment in the fixed income, is it more towards dollar or is it ringgit fixed income?
It's ringgit.
Okay. Yeah.
So so that's kind of, you know, what it is. And on your question on when do I expect to have more, I think that's why I'm constantly explaining to everyone that this is not a short-term journey, right? By 2023, I have a journey which I'm explaining that my business will grow by 25 to 33%. I will be retaining more, which means my expense ratio will get more efficient. And that's the journey we want to take us on. And then there'll be a phase two of that growth, which 2024 to 2027, we will have a phase two. Now, when would our core revenue income be better than the investment income? That's That's something I can't answer now, but all I can tell you is it's not uncommon for general insurers, if you go out there and check their numbers, to actually not... If you go out there and check general insurers, you will find it's not uncommon to have significant portion coming from investment income.
Yeah. Perhaps maybe just one or two more questions on this.
Sure.
Do you guys have, say, a target on, say, ROI for your investments? And is there any mandates on specific investments? Or can you actually just hold, say, a lot of cash? Say you want to hold 50% cash or something. Can you actually
obviously
do that?
Obviously, we have a strategic asset allocation. But can it tactically be changed? Of course, you can go to the investment committee and you can go through a process of why you want to do that if you feel we have to do that. But in terms of target rates, I don't think I can disclose that at this point in time because that kind of becomes a disclosure. But I think broadly, at this point in time, we don't see a mix changing. To what I've mentioned before, but we have shorten the tenure to reduce volatility.
Okay. So just to double confirm, Rohit, basically you're saying that it is you are investing in ringgit bonds and not dollar bonds.
Yes.
Because what we are seeing, a huge volatility even year to date in 2022 is mainly in the dollar bonds, not so much on the ringgit bonds.
Yes, you're right.
Okay, that's good. Okay, Terence, I think, do you have any more question on this? Or maybe we can move on.
I don't know what to ask on related to this kind of dollar bonds and large macro movements. So nothing from me.
Yeah, I think just perhaps we should highlight the audience, right? That maybe when we see TUNEPRO's financials, sometimes it can be up down, but there is some chunk of it which is really linked to the investment portion and not so much on the operational side of things. I think that is very important to take away from here. Yeah. Okay, Terence, your questions.
So okay. there is a linked question from KS Lu on why others enjoy profit. If you're talking about the domestic insurers, they actually had a sizable exposure to a single equity, which invariably is their shareholder bank. And those shareholder banks tend to be strong dividend stocks. We did not have that exposure. And our equity exposure was in ASEAN, in Asia. And as I told you, China tanked last year. Actually, the decision was driven by me and then, of course, approved by the investment committee because one of the feedback I got in these forums, similar forums and speaking to investors was, why don't you sweat your investment? Why are you just having bonds, right? So we went back to the investment committee. We had a proper pitch. We explained that, okay, we need to sweat it. Let's look at equity. And as they always say, we are all investors. I'm also invested in my personal capacity. You can never time the market. If somebody could time the market, they will all be, Warren Buffett. So you can't really time the market. So we went in. The equity market tanked in China and parts of Asia. Do we expect it to come back? Yes.
Nice. So next time, any stock tips or stock advice, we can look out for Rohit as well. Okay.
Not a good time. So volatile, but yeah, anyway.
Yeah,
that's actually a question from Captain. He asked, I'm not sure if you can disclose this, but he asked, what kind of sectors is your equity portion exposed to?
It's quite diversified. Let me come back to you. I'll just check with the team and come back to you on this one. I don't have... Unfortunately, my CFO can't get on for some reason, so let me answer that separately.
All right, sure. No problem. Okay, so let's see. There's a question from Shalista over here. And she is asking, do you have a site, a marketing budget that you spend on to acquire users? And if so, how much is it?
Yes, we do. Roughly 2%. Roughly 2% is our marketing budget. Can it be more? Of course, it can be more. But I think the point is, marketing is an ocean. Marketing is just not about advertising and branding. So you would see some social media influencers promoting us. You will see us, I think, as you speak today, you would have heard us on many of the radios. We are putting up some digital billboards. So you will see a few things. But that's not, for me, that's just one part of marketing. The other part of marketing is what I'm more focused on, which is the strong word of mouth. When I go out there and say, 333, in 3 minutes, you can buy from me. In 3 hours, I will answer your query. In 3 days, I'll settle your claim. Trust me, I get more coverage than any time. When I say I'm the first insurer to put core on the cloud, the coverage is different. When I tie up with all these in these partnerships like EcoWorld and, you know, Bijak and Kuala and Policy Street and I'm getting access to their customer base. Same with AirAsia, right? So I'm getting opportunity to cross-sell, upsell to them. And when it's API, it's much more deep linking, it's much more inbuilt, etc. So yes, we are definitely spending on marketing, but we don't think it's just blindly selling on marketing. The other one, I know there's a few questions asked about customer data, etc., which is linked to marketing. If you look at our customer data, TuneProtect has 4.3 million customers. If you look at TuneProtect has 4.3 million customers. AirAsia has 75 million customers. That's the gold dust that I have, right? That's the real value I have. So if I can cross-sell to my own customer base, if I can cross-sell, upsell to the AirAsia customer base, that's where we're going to make our killing, right? So, and that's why you will see with the Snap Plus that we have launched, we actually have, you know, with the Super Plus today, you can buy a cancellation cover. You know, if you go to AirAsia, there's a host of other things we do with teleport, etc. So that's where we believe our marketing differentiation is going to be. It's really around the call to action.
On that note, actually, yeah, that's another question which is somewhat related by Shafiq over here, where he's asking, you know, do you think that the association of TuneProtect with AirAsia is actually a strong point for the company?
I'm extremely proud, and I can tell you that one of the reasons I joined TuneProtect was because they have AirAsia as one of their key investors and partners. Very simple. What AirAsia has gone through is not because AirAsia did something wrong. Who expected COVID to hit and who expected airlines to not fly for 2 weeks? What do you expect? You know? So for me, it's a huge benefit. I can tell you most of my competitors would die to have, or would kill to have, as some people would say, to have AirAsia as their partner and have 75 million customer access. And we get along very well with AirAsia. Not only are they their investors, not only do we have Irene Omar sitting on our board, but we also work with them very closely on many industry innovations. So yes, we are diversifying our business. Yes, AirAsia is less than 5%. I don't think AirAsia will ever be as significant a business for us as it was before, for the simple reason that even when it comes up, we've built all the other lines that I mentioned to you. Because that's also important as an investor, that's also important as a business, to have that diversification in our business. So AirAsia is going to be on top of what we've built. But having said that, we don't want to be always dependent on just one mother. We need, you know, father, brother, sister, you know, all of that, right? So that's the whole idea that we are working.
I think there is a funny comment here from Nick. Let me just pull it up. AirAsia is now like a call option. Without it, TunePro is okay with it. TunePro Tech like you, okay. I suppose, Rohit, I just want to understand a little bit better, right? Like, can you explain a little bit more about the synergy, or say the interdependence, as well as the relationship between yourself, TUNEPRO Tech, and AirAsia from, say, a qualitative and quantitative perspective. So, for instance, we know that, you know, they are your largest shareholder. I believe it's 20% over, if I'm not mistaken, or was it 13%? And just now you did mention that you can leverage on their 75 million users. But other than that, in terms of, is there any other qualitative or quantitative things that you can share with us? And how are you guys, what's the interdependence and synergy?
So a few things. First things first, AirAsia owns 14% of TUNEPRO Tech, and TUNE Group, which Tony and Datuddin run, have another close to 15 plus percent. Now coming back, Irene Omar sits on our group board. We have regular meetings with them on different ideas. So today with AirAsia, today with AirAsia, we actually have a host of products we sell through the airline. You go on the airline, you go on the super app, you can see insurance dial. We work with Teleport to insure their riders. We are constantly looking at, we launched with Super Plus. We are looking at new things like AirAsia Money. We are live on AirAsia Money as well. So we are growing as they grow. As their business grows, we grow with them. So there is a great synergy in that, that, as you know, we are their exclusive insurance partner for AirAsia. So obviously that provides us that support and that leg to work with them. Qualitatively, what I really like about AirAsia is they are just fast. They are just fast. They're always thinking about what next. And for me, that's great because I want to disrupt the market. And I'm constantly looking at how can I leverage them. So, that's you know how we are looking at it. In terms of quantitative, as I mentioned, AirAsia today is less than 5%, but that's because of the current situation. We expect that to go back up, but not as much as it was before in pre-COVID times.
Would you say that you expect business from AirAsia to go back up, not as much as it was before? Is it
We expect it to go back to pre-COVID levels, but as a percentage, it won't be 90% of travel insurance. Because as I said, I have Air Arabia, I have Salam Air, I have 2,500 travel agents, I have Bamboo Air, I have another airline in Vietnam, I have Agoda, and I have many other platforms. None of this was there three years back. So I don't expect AirAsia to be 90% of my travel sales. I expect AirAsia to be back to pre-COVID levels at some point, not this year, but at some point. But even at that time, I expect AirAsia's contribution to be lower as a percentage than what it was in 2019.
Because the business has grown that much more.
We have 50 over partners. 18 months back when I joined, we had 3 partners. Okay. And one of them was AirAsia. So.
Yeah, very good. Very good progress over the past 2 years.
Terence, if I may just ask, right?
Since Hao is on, can I just... So that the team doesn't feel I ran away from the question, right? Hao, the question was on the bond investments. Where have we invested the investments? That was the question.
Where, as in like exactly which funds, or because basically what most sort of bond investment are.
Go sorry. Ahead. No, I guess the question that somebody asked was, what sort of equity sectors have we invested in, and also whether the bond was ringgit. I confirmed that to them already. So I guess in terms of our equity, where is our exposure?
Okay, equity basically as of like December last year, we have about 8.9% of our portfolio are invested in equity funds. We do not hold equities directly, out of that, basically, approximately less than 2% are actually exposures to Greater China's funds. And for the remaining 6% are actually in Asia-Pac equity markets. So we invest actually via funds and not a direct exposure in selecting or pick and choose with specific equity accounts. And all those equity funds that we invested in are also ringgit denominated. I mean, the funds was actually priced in ringgit terms as well. On bonds, basically, they are also local. Because I think if you understand that, basically, we do have this foreign exposure limited by Bank Negara's ruling of up to 10% of no more than 10% of investment portfolio will be actually in foreign. Yeah. Currently, we have not really utilized that. Yeah. If that answers the question, so.
Yes, I think that answers the question. Yeah. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hao. Yeah.
Okay, I think back to Rohit, maybe just one last question with regards to the marketing budget, right? Maybe if I can just expand that a little bit. I suppose we have seen, for instance, with Lemonade and how their previous fourth quarter result came about and, you know, how they were being sold off after their quarter four result. And one of the main reason why people sell off is they are very unhappy with the company's free cash flow burn. And I suppose we just would like to understand for Tune Protect, what is the company's free cash flow burn target to spend on, say, things like R&D in perfecting your technology and applications, as well as on top of the marketing spending? Is it like a percentage of revenue as just now what you mentioned?
Okay, so marketing is percentage. On the tech side, let me ask how to answer the capex bit. It's already all been disclosed. So maybe how you can just answer the capex bit and the qualitative bit, I'll try to answer.
Yeah, sure. Capex, I think last we disclosed, I think we do the biggest capex projects that basically we are having is actually on our core insurance platforms. That is actually the backbones of actually allowing us to spin out actually different kind of product, I think, fast enough. I don't think that basically, maybe just one point to clarify, we are positive. We are not negative free cash flow in terms of we are burning cash in generating income. So I think that's a very fundamental. We are not, we are startup mindset, but not exactly startup behavior that burn the money to generate top lines or generate business. We also still emphasis on healthy, actually, bottom line. CapEx investment is pretty much, I think, to meet the needs of our digital offerings. So the biggest one, as I mentioned, is approximately 30 million that we are investing on our core insurance platforms. That is likely going to last us for the next decade to support, I think, the growth, I think, of both Malaysia's and as well as, I think, our associate company as well. Other than that, I think from what Rohit mentioned as well, in our investment into health segments, we have also allocated in the next 3 years approximately of 13 million, I think, actually to actually build up the platforms for us to be able to reach out to the market, I think, digitally. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Hao. Terence, next question.
Okay. All right. So there's a long question from Viva. In fact, it's too long that it can't display now. I'll read it out from the Facebook chat box. So he says that, yeah, it's great that you have taken advantage of the trend regarding hyper-personalization and leveraging of data from the various partners to better underwrite products for the younger generation regarding likes and dislikes. So he has three questions. Number one, with the increase of health data points coming in from smart wearables, do you see the medical premiums for the industry coming down as a whole for the consumer? Number two, how is Tune Protect rebuilding the connection with the consumer in an age where emotional trust makes for a value proposition? And number three, will we see Tune Protect compete with the bigger players such as Allianz, AIA, AXA in the next 5 to 10 years? yeah, that's the three questions that he
proposed. Okay, great question. I'll answer the third one because I think I answered it briefly before. I won't compete with the big boys. The big boys will continue to play their business. They have huge number of agents. They have huge banker partnership where they've spent billions, in some cases billions. I don't think I will be competing with them, and I don't intend to compete with them. For them, it's a lot more difficult to do what I'm doing. Can they launch something in 3 days? I can put an open challenge. No other insurer can do that in Malaysia. Full stop. I'm not arrogant when I say this, but I'm really saying this. No other insurer can launch in 3 days. I can launch from concept to launch in 20 days. Can anybody do it? I can bet it. Nobody can. So my differentiation, my challenge is a different group. I'm looking at how I can focus on millennials and zillennials and build a business around them. So I don't intend to compete with the big boys. The big boys will continue to have their traditional business. And I'm hoping to be the next big boy for this future generation who's going to become wealthier, richer, you know, older, and buy more products in the time to come so that I can build greater lifetime value. Will health premiums go down or go up? I don't think there's a straightforward answer to that, because health insurance premiums could go down if the features are lower. The fundamental problem in Malaysia for health insurance is four-pronged. First one is medical inflation pre-COVID was between 13 to 15%. The second one was health insurance business became a red ocean, which meant that everybody was competing with each other on whose features are better. At one point, we started removing inner limits and everybody started saying everything as charged. Once you went into as charged, everybody was abusing it and the market became very difficult. Third one, we don't control hospital costs. So I can never say why hospital A charged Y for a certain condition and hospital A charged B for the same condition. The fourth one is employee medical tourism, as it's called in Southeast Asia. Because there's no skin in the game for employees, employees are okay to go and lie down in a hospital for a shoulder problem. In my previous company, we did a very simple control mechanism where we assessed and we said if it's a shoulder problem with no procedure or no, you know, nothing material done, it's cash and it's pay and file, which means it's reimbursement basis, no more cashless. For 13-14% of the claim being shoulder related admissions, this came down to less than 5%. What does it tell you? The minute you don't have cashless, 8%, 9% of the people don't want to go to the hospital anymore. So there's a lot of behavioral change we have to go through in the industry. So what have we done? That's why we have simplified our health product to say you buy a 600 ringgit product instead of buying a 3000 ringgit product, which means I can make it cheaper for you, but I'm controlling the limits. Why am I controlling the limits? Because 95% of the claims is below a certain limit anyway. Why solve for the 5% when your income level is low? As you get wealthier, you can buy the most complex, the most comprehensive, the most highest end cover, and you can take advice, etc. So I don't think there's a straightforward answer for this. Will wearables help the premium? Yes. Can people get discounts? Yes. But I can tell you the average steps taken by a Malaysian is 3,400 steps a day. Only 3% of Malaysians walk 10,000 steps a day. So if I say today I'm going to launch a contest saying walk 10,000 steps a day, I give you 20% discount, less than 3% of the people are going to claim it. So yes, for that 3%, you're going to see a discount. You're going to see a reduction in premium. For the rest, you're not going to see. So I think that's where there's no straightforward answer. It depends on medical inflation. It depends on what sort of schemes we offer. And of course, for the healthier people, there will definitely be a discount. It's just like telematics. You drive better, you get a better discount. You take care of your health, you get a better discount. But that'll be a small size. Sorry, I missed the second question. Can you tell me the second question?
Yes, the second question was, how is Tune rebuilding the connection with the consumer in an age where emotional trust makes for a value proposition?
Great question. I think there's three levels. What our consumer study says is, for millennials and zillennials, along with the three product lines I mentioned, three things matter to them. The first one is simplicity. The second one is price. And the third one is trust. And insurers are not trusted very high, as you all know. So that's why we have made our products very simple. You can buy in 3 minutes. You can buy on our mobile app with a few clicks. Our products are affordable, so you can buy as cheap as we can offer it and you can afford to buy, or you can buy as costly as you want to buy by adding more feature. And our products are quite simple. It can be bought online, it can be bought to a distributor, it can be bought to a partner. And what we are seeing in the market is a very clear trend, right? If you trust a telco, you don't want to come to an insurer and buy an insurance. You want to buy it with a telco. If you trust a health company, you want to buy it at the health company. So that's why what our API does, what Prashant does, is he and his team are able to facilitate this purchase journey at the partner site so that we don't have to get into these customer experience conversations of moving from point A to point B, because of which the customer falls away, there's bounce rates, et cetera, which is e-commerce language. But ideally, we want to go where the customer wants to go. That's our message.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Rohit. I think we want to actually take some questions regarding the app. Yeah, actually, there's a lot of questions about the business in general. And, you know, we want to ask some questions about the app.
Yeah, well. Let's focus on the technology in the app.
Yeah, the technology is part of things. Yeah, Rondi, maybe you want to get the ball rolling?
Just let me, maybe let's go with Gibson's question here first. Gibson is asking, can you help us understand how TunePro monetized through its app and its tech? How much cost savings or operating leverage do you get from this as compared to conventional insurance business?
Prashanta, you want to start and then I can join you? Maybe you can give it a tech view and then, yeah.
And Prashanta, if I may just add to this question, perhaps Prashanta, can you also help the audience to visualize the scalability of how TunePro through its app, right, can be like, where is the big scalable monetization from this digitalization?
Yeah, okay, sure. So let me take it one by one. The first one was, can you help us to understand how TunePro monetized through his app and tech? So TunePro, what we do offer our technology to potential partner to capture business. What does it mean? It means, for example, our insurance business, when it goes to other markets where we are not a licensed insurer, they do carry the tech also. So we do the product, we use our technology to build the product. The example I gave earlier, like parametric, where you get an instant claim and all, this was not in our market, but in a Vietnam market, right? Then we also go to our potential partners to explore the partnership where we can license our technology to power up their product and service offerings. So this is another way how we can monetize through our app and tech. The second part of it was how much cost savings do you get compared to other conventional business. So as a principle, we do use open source technology to lower our cost and to manage overall TCO. For example, we don't use expensive software like an Oracle in our platform, right? The other part of it is the reusability of the technology stack, which means we had a mobile app in Malaysia. We launched using the same principle, same mobile architecture in Thailand. So what it has done, if you go to the market, a normal mobile app, I mean, for an insurer would take maybe, I don't know, maybe between 12 and 15 months, and we could do it in Thailand in 4 months flat because we reuse the technology. So we are we are doing some cost savings. We are standardizing our platform. This is how we are doing this. And the other part is what kind of scalability we can do it. So one of the, we do use microservices running on Kubernetes cluster. This could sound very, very technical, but this is kind of what it is happening in a software engineering world across the business, like e-commerce platform and all. Now I give an example of that. So prior to pre-COVID, they do run promotions, right? On their free seat campaigns and all. I mean, we have online connectivity with the AirAsia platform through APIs. On a peak days, we used to run 100,000 policies, which was used by the platform, which means it has that scalability where we can scale up or scale down based on our requirement. Rohit, you want to add something?
No, I just want to add that, you know, sometimes people don't see how advanced our tech is, right? Cover Genius, which is a very highly invested VC PE company, which is several hundreds of millions of dollars went in. Last year, they sold 11 million policies on their tech. Last year, just in Middle East, we sold 6.5 million policies on our tech. Touch wood, it never went down. There was never an issue. And pre-COVID, AirAsia did about 11 million as well. So you can imagine the scalability we have on our tech.
And would you say that you guys in the future, say in the next 3 to 5 years, would go to the similar route to, say, a Lemonade, where you're going to develop some AI to learn about your customer database?
Three to 5 years is too long.
We already have started, right? I give a very small example, which you will give you an understanding. So dynamic pricing, right, which is dependent on AI. Now you are flying from Kuala Lumpur to Melbourne, and you and I are sitting next to each other in an economy class. Your insurance premium might be very different than mine. And how does it happen? It's based on various parameters, on affinity, how much time you have traveled with us, and all those things, right? Those are all data-driven. Now, are we doing in large-scale AI and all those? No, we are picking up certain use cases, and then we are seeing which are the hard-hitting ones. That's how we are doing it, because it is a use case-driven, right? It's not, we are not doing it for all the products or everything, but we are picking up certain use cases and trying it out.
Okay, there is a follow-up question here from Nick, and he's talking about your app, and I suppose I also feel the same with him, right? In the sense that I think you briefly touched on this about how you're gonna create some health tech and all that, but how do you plan to make your users keep coming back to your app instead of just
There's a few phases for this, as I mentioned before. Phase one was to have the mobile app. So today you can buy, you can service, you can claim on the app. Phase two is by end of May, June, we should have our health tech up. With the health tech, we'll start tracking your sleep, your steps, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And with the driving data that we have from you that you're uploading already, plus the health data and the claims data we will have, by the end of the year, we will be giving you hyper-personalization and hyper-customization, where actually we can give the customer special discounts, special offers. You will also notice in June some really special engagement methods, which I don't want to give it away, but you will see that. For sure. There is a clear strategy. Sorry, go ahead, Prashant.
No. So just want to add and to add to what you said, we also want to bring in some kind of gamification, right? I mean, we all do understand, right, an insurance app is not so much frequently used. So you have to make it fun, the gamification, the health tech, all those things what Rohit was saying, and a few more other things. When you bring those up, then the usability goes up, right? It's not an e-commerce where you order a diaper or something like, or a news channel which you are constantly checking on the news, right? So we do understand that.
Okay. Darren, maybe I'll just ask one more related question and then I'll pass the floor to you. So I suppose, Prashanta, can you perhaps let us know what is the latest numbers, you know, when it comes to number of downloads, the number of users, active users, use cases through the app? And are we able to track right now the current premium per user? And
so those are stats, Randy, we have not yet given the market. What we have told the market over the last 12 months, so we're taking you on a journey. We first told them we will start tracking NPS. We did a baseline of NPS. Then we started showing them NPS results. Then we announced the 3-3-3 strategy. Then we started giving data on how are we performing on the 3-3-3. So we mentioned about 87%, etc. The next step you will see this quarter is we'll start releasing customer data, which will say how much customer did we acquire. In terms of the app usage, our current plan is to release this data starting Q3, because by when we will have the health tech and gamification up and running.
Okay. And just for my knowledge, how many app or web developers do you guys have in TuneProtect? And are they mainly local?
It's a mix of local as well as foreign talent. I mean, this is something which I want to highlight. COVID has put a lot of stress on getting a tech talent. And I mean, I'm not saying for us, but across the industry, like all the industry wants to go digital, right? Even the cafe next door will try to sell products. I mean, the offerings through digitally, right? Everyone wants a developer out there. So hiring and retaining talent is a big challenge in the tech world across industry vertical. Currently, we have around 25 core developers across multiple technologies. And we are aggressively looking to hire more, because not only to support our internal business, as we said in the beginning, that we are trying to monetize the tech platform, where we will require much more than what we have today on the developers front, right? But there are much bigger people who are doing operations and all, but I'm talking specifically on the development side.
And most of these are local Malaysians, is it?
No, it's a mix. I mean, with an edge towards the local Malaysians, but now we are starting to look out because we are not getting talent locally.
Okay.
For the app, like, how's the take-up rate so far, do you feel? Like, from the Play Store, from the iStore?
It can be better. It can be better. But as I mentioned to you, we are hoping that Q3, Q4, you see more usage. Right now, it's quite low. Right now, people still come to our website. But on the tech side, you know, our API usage is quite high. We can, on a good day, we can issue 400,000 API quotes a day. And as I said, 6.5 million policies were sold only in Middle East online, and about 1 million outside Middle East. So we last year had about 7.5 million.
And on a day-to-day basis also, as we partner on we expand our partnership with the bigger koalas of the world, there are much more quotes are being being generated online through them, through the APIs from their platform, because they are where the customers are coming in, right? And they're connecting to us to get the quotes of various products which we are hosting into their platform.
Terence, I think there are a few questions from the floor which are pretty good. Do you want maybe one from Mr. Lu?
Which one are you looking at?
Yeah, maybe this one. Yeah.
Okay, that's a great question. So I think no worries, Mr. Liu. I think when we say increasing retention ratio, we are increasing in our three lines of business only, which is SME, health, and lifestyle. And SME, health, and lifestyle have our best underwriting margins. All three are profitable, and that's where we want to retain our business. And these are not large claims, so the severity also tends to be lower. But the frequency will be more because products like motor and health will have more frequency, but your severity will be lower. So we don't see that as an issue.
Okay. However, Rohit,
we expect a certain deterioration of claims to happen, which is natural because, for example, we are doing a lot of PA business. Is PA business profitable to partners? It's very profitable. The loss ratio is 45%. The loss ratio of travel is 5%. So if travel is 5%, PA is 45%, is my loss ratio deteriorating? Yes. Am I still making money? Yes. So obviously the more travel I sell, the more home I sell, the more profitable it is. But having said that, we do expect some deterioration of the loss ratio.
Yeah, Rohit, maybe just to follow on to Mr. Liu's question, right? Because I believe just now you are championing this slogan 333. So, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but TUNEPRO seems to really champion accepting applications and process insurance claims quickly as one of its core strengths. So whilst all this is good for consumers, you know, as a consumer, I would definitely love it. But it could actually perhaps backfire for the company and its shareholders, can it? You know, case in point, right? For instance, as you mentioned earlier, how the flood at the end of last year sort of affected your previous quarter's performance. So how do you actually ensure that your tech system is accurate in its risk assessment score whilst sort of like prohibiting to your 333 slogan?
I think the traditional way of thinking was paying claims faster means you will end up paying more claims. Actually, the new way of thinking with technology is the more rules you have, the more efficiency you have in your process. No paper is a big saving as well. In fact, I think the efficiency will improve. As an example, I can tell you, 2020, we had a backlog of claims. 2021, I have zero backlog. So obviously, it's a much more efficient scenario we are sitting in. When I say zero backlog, I mean normal backlog was there, which is 1 month before, 2 weeks before, those kind of stuff. I mean, there was no, you know, several backlogs sitting. So I think fast does not mean inefficient. There's still rules that we have to follow. There's still checks and balance in terms of quality checking, fraud investigation, etc., that apply. So it doesn't mean that just because we are fast, we are missing the assessment. A very simple example is when we launched COVID travel, many people thought COVID travel would be value destroying. You've seen it in the results. COVID travel is making profits. Now, why were we able to do that? We have certain controls. Controls are, with any partner we work with, first control was you have to have a negative PCR 3 days before you arrive. So already we found the incidences were lower. The second control we have was with any partner, we have a clear clause which says if the loss ratio deteriorates to a certain percentage, we can withdraw the product, full stop. So there are always checks and balances that we have in place, which helps managing our risk. For sure.
Okay, that's good to know. Because, I mean, as me and Terence were playing with your app, it's like a few clicks and you're, oh, okay, I can actually get this. And then, if let's say suddenly, you know, something
but
happened
to me. But I can tell you, right, it's not as straightforward as that because there will be someone else who's not a common customer who says, click, 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 I couldn't buy. Because my underwriting rule doesn't allow them to buy. For example, if today you have an Alphard car, and you want to buy the Alphard car on my digital app, unfortunately, you won't be able to because it's a referred risk. But if you are you have a normal car, you can buy it. So there's obviously rules that have gone into creating that.
That's good. Rohit, I think, I'm not sure if I missed your point just now, but you mentioned just now about the gross loss ratio. Is there a target for Tune Protect? What is the target for the gross loss ratio?
Because there's no target. What we have told the market is we expect over the next 2 to 3 years for the combined ratio to be around the market average. Today, what we have is our loss ratio is generally much better than the industry claims ratio, but our expense ratio is significantly worse than the industry. The reason why expense ratio is significantly worse was because A, we were not growing, B, we were not retaining enough, and because of that, the expense was the numerator was too big for the denominator. The focus now is to grow that denominator, A, by growing the business, and B, by retaining more. So there'll be a double kicker on the denominator. As a result of that, your expense ratio should improve. And as I mentioned, I expect we haven't given a target, but I expect our expense ratio to materially improve over the planned period. But I also expect our loss ratio to slightly, become worse off because, you know, we're not just doing travel, or we're not just doing reinsurance commercial business where we make a lot of reinsurance inward commission. Obviously, we are now doing a lot more business like PA and motor, and, you know, home and pet. And all these products don't have a travel and commercial lines kind of loss ratio profile. So naturally, there'll be a deterioration of claims, but there'll be an improvement in expense ratio. And over the plan period, we expect to get closer to the industry average.
Sorry, what's the industry average, just for my information?
It's around 90 to 92.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, Terence?
Yeah, well, actually, there's a lot of information and a lot of, industry knowledge that's being shared by Rohit, you know, dropping pearls of wisdom in this industry that I'm still trying to wrap my head around, really. And it's actually very, very interesting that how you are developing this tech and this app as well. So typically, you know, a lot when people think of, you know, tech, so-called tech companies, they are like more on a startup kind of basis, right? But on Tune Protect, you know, you have to balance being innovative and, you know, putting in expenditure to develop this app. At the same time, you also need to balance, your responsibilities to the shareholder for generating profits and having a, you know, sustainable profit. So how do you say, like, juggle, you know, between being a startup at the same time also being a public listed, you know, sort of, you know, kind of like mature company?
Not an easy job.
No, I think it's a very exciting job. I think let's be clear, right? Tune Protect is not an AXA, it's not an AIA, it's not an AIG, okay? Because we're not an established company and we don't intend to behave like one. I can't compete with the big boys by behaving like the big boys. My only differentiation is speed and innovation, full stop. Okay, everything else companies can copy. Where they can't copy is they can't copy speed, they can't copy innovation, they can't copy culture. Culture is very difficult to build. So one of our 8 commitments to the market has to be, you know, an employer of choice among millennials. And that's where, you know, we have successfully been targeting millennials, not only as customers, but also as employees, as we need employees who understand millennials. As an example, we're launching monthly payment option for our health plans because millennials don't want annual payment. And to shape this culture, we have announced 4 values, which are slightly also different from what you would see. One is make it simple. Second is customer obsessed, which probably is common. Better together and be curious and be bold. We want our team to be curious and be bold. So a lot of innovation comes there. And that's something you can see in our employee NPS. You can see in our customer NPS, partner NPS, which is touch wood, all positive. And that's where a lot of the innovation we are driving. Now, on your question on managing shareholder expectation and innovation, I think the two go hand in hand. We're a listed company, so obviously we can't be cowboys. And that's the point how mentioned, right? There's a stated expense plan, and we will obviously stick to that. And that's a common conversation we have at the board. Do we expect challenges? Do we expect tweaks from here and there? Of course, when you are small, you will expect volatility. You will expect new challenges, new opportunities. But you will also see high growth. So our focus as a business has to be on growth. At this point in time, the more we grow, the more efficient we become, the business will take care of itself. If we are going to be short-term focused and say, next quarter, can you give me X? That's the wrong way to drive the business. But if we are focused on 2023 and say 2023, this is the journey, 25 to 33% CAGR, 70% net written premium, improve your expense ratio. We understand your claims ratio will deteriorate. Grow your tech business, acquire more customers, let them stay longer with us, buy more from us, and make it a sustainable business from an ESG element. I think for me, that's success. The rest, how the market takes this as a success, whether the bottom line is enough, whether the story is enough, I don't control that. But my story will be to show high growth, high retention, high innovation, good culture. That's what it's about.
Okay, great. I think we are nearing 2 hours already.
Yeah.
Wow. Terence, maybe let's just ask one or two last questions. You want to go first or I go first?
You go ahead, please.
Okay. I think, Rohit, one of the thing which strikes me the most is your highlights in terms of corporate culture and how you are mentioning that this cannot easily be replicated from the conventional insurance big boys, right? So I'm just wondering, just a touch on this. what philosophy are you actually looking to build in terms of culture? And why is this different or better than the conventional insurance companies? I think these are the things that you have mentioned just now. Maybe can you give us some example of KPIs which you track to ensure that the culture is actually shaping up well?
Okay. My head of e-commerce is not tracked on how much he sells. My head of e-commerce is tracked on what percentage of his customer bought insurance in 3 minutes. Because my view is when that happens, the sale will happen. And we are seeing the e-commerce business grow very strongly. Now, what I mean by that is, too many times as industry, as investors, as insurers, we track lag KPIs. Of course, the CFO is going to track it and it's his job and he's going to challenge all of us on the lag KPI. Totally understand. But our focus has to be on lead KPIs. Are we acquiring more customers? Are they staying longer with us? Are they buying more from us? Are they happy with us? Those are the KPIs that I follow through with the team. If there's a customer, you know, I put myself on any social media. You can come, there are customers who are complaining to me. When the customer complaint happens, I put myself out there. There's a chat group. We are chatting saying, why did this complaint come? What can we learn from this? And every day we are learning. I'll give you one example. Recently, there was a customer complaint which said, I didn't get paid for travel delay because my flight started late and we said no. And in the team, someone said, you should pay the claim. Another person said, don't pay the claim because it's not delay on arrival, it's delay on departure. And somebody else said, pay half the claim. I said, try explaining this to the customer, right? If this is how complex you are. But this is how we challenge ourselves. The tradition, we don't think like traditional insurers. We are always challenging ourselves saying, how can we make it simple for the customer? And the customer complaint is one thing I won't tolerate. And that's why the team are always looking out for it. Team are always looking out saying, what's the customer saying? What can we do? How can we improve? I believe that will naturally drive a certain culture across the company. For me, there are three, before I joined TUNEPRO Tech in my previous company, we're the number one in digital life insurance in Malaysia with 49% market share. And from then to here, I've had three simple philosophies why digital businesses work. The first one is culture. You have to have a culture of failing fast and waking up. We've had partners who we launched and we thought they're going to be the most successful partner and only sold 4 policies. We've had partners who we thought this partner is not going to be successful, who've sold 100,000 policies. That's the nature of the game. In digital, you have to be ready to fail, wake up, and move on. And that's where agile and lean and all of this come in. The second one is in digital, technology is very important. We are extremely API friendly. You speak to any partner, they'll tell you, wow, TUNEPRO Tech too fast. InstaHome said the reason why they chose us over somebody else who they had already advanced was because there's nobody faster than us. Okay. The third is the tone from the top. I am very clear, all channels can coexist. Whether your digital partnership, traditional channel can coexist because each customer has a different behavior. I am not held, to my decision-making by any one channel. I'm free to make my decision, which traditional businesses cannot. So I think that is my biggest differentiator. And encapsulating all of this is the team I have. I would recommend all of you on this meeting to go and check out our team's profile. Find me one insurance company with this kind of profile. I have a CFO who was, with a leading consulting house, with AirAsia before. I have a CTO who's worked in every country I can think of, except with the penguins in Antarctica. he's worked with telcos. Have a chief partnership officer who's driven sales in multiple organizations. My CEO of Thailand was a CEO of Bupa before, CEO of Aegon before. He's a strong digital health portfolio person. Have a CEO in Middle East who's a travel guru. I have hired data experts, health experts. Have a look at the profile we have. You'll be surprised at how diverse the profile is. And then, of course, the access we have to the AirAsia ecosystem is really who we are.
So if I can easily summarize, some of the biggest strength of TUNEPRO Tech is basically your culture as well as the ecosystem that you guys are having at the moment, from the current one and the future, basically.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, very nice to know. Very great. I think we should start to wrap up, Rondi.
Do you want to have a quick fire questions? I think there are just 2 or 3 fire questions which you can answer in a few sentences.
Sure. Okay. Please go.
Okay. So firstly, let me see. Sorry, 1 second. So Liki here is asking, when TUNEPRO Tech is going to roll out critical illness cover for Malaysia?
It will be in Q2. Thank you for noticing. Yes, it's been delayed. The reason it's been delayed is every time we're ready to launch, something is there in the market which we need to observe, as competitors, etc. So we're quite confident we'll launch it in Q2. But we'll keep you posted if there's a change.
Okay. Viva is asking, do you think that the agency model is at a threat of declining going forward? Maybe Viva is an insurance agent. So
fine. I don't think so. My own view is agents will remain relevant. I call it agency 2.0. what do I mean by that? And I've written a blog on that. You can hit me up on rohitnambiar.blogspot. I regularly blog, off late, not much, but I do write thought leadership articles from time to time. Anyway, coming back to the question, two parts to this. Low involvement products like travel, motor, PA, home is going to go online, full stop. There's no emotion there. The products are too similar. I know agents keep saying motor, very different. Motor is not very different. All motor products are very similar with some exceptions. Okay, so I think these products will go online. There'll be a small percentage left, which will be more relationship sales. Beyond that, all this is going through digital means because there is purely price. There's no emotional attachment. Higher involvement, complex products like health insurance, more higher end health insurance, legacy planning, commercial lines, SME coverage. These products need advice. And I believe agency model will continue to remain relevant. My own view is the number of agents will come down, but the value they do will go up. Why? Because you'll have more professionals selling insurance. And these agents also have more time because unlike before, they don't have to drive their car, park their car in KL, you know, parking lots, go and meet four or five clients in a day. Today, they can sit at home, just like right now we are talking, sell over Zoom. Many of the tools are inbuilt into Zoom now, many of the sales tools, they can sell to you. So the productivity will be significantly better than what it was earlier.
Okay, and maybe just one of two last quick questions. Why does TUNEPRO wants to scale down the commercial insurance? And
yeah, good question. We don't want to do commercial insurance is not true. We don't want to do commercial insurance, low retention business. Why? Because we are an insurer. When we do large commercial low retention business, we essentially become a glorified reinsurance broker, which means we have so many staff, but we are retaining so little. And it goes back to my earlier debate, your denominator is too small to manage your expenses. And the risk is also high. So what we want to do is focus on businesses, the three businesses which we believe are profitable and where our retention will be higher. So the denominator is higher, so the expense can be managed by it. And we can, you know, drive our combined ratio over the next 3 years to industry levels. And that's why we want to exit this business so that we can really focus on what's our strength, which is consumer-driven retail business.
Okay. And just, I think Mr. Lu here is, just want to reconfirm, TPT losses has been cleaned up. Does it mean this past business will not affect TUNEPRO profitability? I think this is on the associate level.
Sure. How do you want to take that question?
I don't have to comment. I think while we are in the insurance business, right, of course, there's we insure risk. So, of course, what we meant is like whatever that we identified the loss, the root cause of the loss was especially to do with a specific policy account. And that has already expired as of August 2021. So we believe all these claims that already come in as already reflected in. But we continue to be an insurance business, meaning that we insure risk, I think, of our customers. So, of course, we are very mindful. We watch our policy and our claims ratio very closely. But to give any kind of assurance that, yeah, we will not be actually have any big losses in case a flood come in or anything, I don't think we can give that kind of assurance. Maybe one word of comfort I can give is perhaps like leveraging on what he was saying, right? I mean, the industry claims ratio and net claims ratio is approximately at 50%. And 2021, ours is at 20%. Even we are talking about we expand into other areas, we are still talking about maybe in the range of 30%. It's still going to be way lower than the industry average. I think that's maybe what I can say. Yeah.
Okay. And there are just two final recommendations, I would say. Kasia here is saying that TUNEPRO should consider work closely with the bank as a strong support.
Would love to, Kasia, but you know, many of these banks unfortunately have exclusive relationships either in JV or long-term partnerships, so it's difficult to break it. It's one of the things I have been speaking a lot, saying like in some other countries, regulators have forced banks to be open architecture. I'm hoping at some time that happens in Malaysia too, which means like many of these banks have traditional insurance partners, but for their digital, these partners cannot help them. So if I get a chance, I would love to do it. But remember, digital banking is coming up. We are in talks with some of the consortiums there. So obviously that's the next opportunity for us. And frankly, the word digital bank, unless the digital bank provides the tech and the infrastructure, I don't see many insurers who can offer what they want better than us.
Yeah. And lastly, I think that there's another recommendation. Nick is saying, I hope Rohit stays for a long time.
Okay. Inshallah, as they say, God willing.
Okay, I think with this, we can wrap up, Terence.
Yeah. Wow, it's been a really, really, really insightful, you know, two plus hour session. Thank you so much, Rohit, Prasanta, and Mr. Hao for, you know, coming here tonight.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, it's been a really great session. And to our guests, I'm sorry if we didn't manage to answer all your questions, because really the reception was very great. By all means, please continue the discussion on TunePro. We can discuss about the questions that were not answered on our Stockbit platform. And we can also discuss about the company and there as well.
And I think just for your listeners, you know, we are very approachable as a company, so you can contact our investor relation team. I'm very active in social media, so you can always hook me up, and you know, I'm happy to answer through Stockbit or directly to us. We are very open, happy to answer. And thank you to both of you, Terence as well as Randy, for this opportunity. We're very happy to be here and hope we gave your customers as well as your users a better view of who TunePro Tech is. I truly believe that we can be ASEAN's real insurtech. We have all the recipe required for it.
Yep. Okay, thank you. Don't forget to, you know, check out their app. I think this is the best way of really understanding what they are trying to do.
Yes. If you are, you know, thinking of being a shareholder, or if you're already a shareholder, the best way is definitely, you know, you get to familiarize yourself with the company's products. So, yeah, download the app, play around with it. I think it's quite clean and intuitive, but I personally have not really, you know, gotten a policy yet. But yeah, I think it's good if everybody, you know, tries it out.
Yeah, and this is coming from me and Terence, right? Who we ourselves are trying to build our own investment tech, right? So, yeah. Anyways, thank you everybody. Stay safe and good night. Rohit and team maybe can just stay back for 1 minute.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Good night, everyone. Good night.
Stay safe. We'll catch you on our next session. Bye bye.
Yes.